Hello and welcome back to Vintage Story. We are, well, this is not going to be the most exciting episode, but I mean, like, you know, this is a series with incremental progress in mind, so I, you know, take it for what it's worth. This one's going to be called Grunt Work, because there's going to be a lot of grunt work in this, and very little actual progress, or you know, technologically speaking, anyway. But we're back on that clay forming grind. I'm going to be making shingles again, if you can believe it. Honestly, I really didn't think I was going to be making shingles anytime soon. But yeah, we're going to be making a ton of shingles today. Don't worry, I've time-lapsed quite a lot of that. So just to spare you the actual aging of your lifespan as I waste every moment of it. I'm going to be making some more ingot molds because I've gotten to the point where I now have a kind of comfortable, you know, rut or format of doing things when it comes to smelting and also smithing. So I can, you know, I'm happy to make two different kinds of alloys at once. Or if I want to make one alloy, I think I can get away with 16 ingot molds. 8 has served me well, but having 16 would, I don't know if I, like, I don't know if one crucible will be enough for, like, 1600 units of any one material. But I'm going to give it a try, and having them doesn't hurt. And also, I have a lot of extra table space, so that, you know, it just seemed like a good idea. But here you can see I was talking about putting the kit pilns in that area, and like they're right next to that wooden post. I have a pretty good feeling that they will, that fire will spread to those wooden posts. So I don't know what I'm gonna do. Maybe I'll just try it and see if it happens, and I don't mind remaking those, you know, one of those posts. I'm kind of hoping the fact that they're chiseled will exploit a little bit, meaning that they're no longer technically wood and therefore they will not burn, but I don't know. It makes sense to me that they would burn, so I'm really playing with fire here. Haha, oh god, make it stop. So, anyway, we're gonna be making some more tanning fluid. I don't know what you call it, tan? Just call tannin, I suppose. And I need both weak and strong tannin. And we're gonna be doing that while there's a temporal storm, a medium temporal storm. And these have become very, like, I didn't even know it was happening because I totally just didn't pay attention to the log, so not a big deal. If I got caught, like, outside, maybe it would matter, but whatever. It's an opportunity to get some extra housework done, like smelting some stuff and maybe making a few tools and also, you know, doing some clay forming, making some shingles. We're going to be making some shingles because that's what we do. This is the shingle channel now. Here I'm like playing with this format. Someone in the comments, I'm sorry, I always forget who, said if you hold the control button and scroll, you can very easily put ingots in and pull them out. Like, basically, you can play with the numbers a bit more easily, and that does make things a lot more easy, because then you can, you know, when it comes to alloys that require three different materials, you can very easily kind of just like tweak things around a bit until you find the right ratio, and yeah, makes the whole thing a lot easier. You don't even really need to know how much of each, like percentage-wise of each resource you need. You just need to like find the kind of ballpark, and then you can play with the amount of each one. So this is, I think, the easiest way to make ingot molds now. I've you know, gotten to a point where I've gotten very used to clay forming, and I think that actually it's easier to use the 3x3 placing grid for just about everything, and then removing clay rather than adding on. There are obvious exceptions, of course. The shingles, I've found now like a pretty much ideal way of making shingles that is pretty reliable. We're finally getting closure. I've had this like pickaxe mold half filled with tin bronze sitting there for like I don't know how many episodes, and I finally filled it with the rest of the tin it needs, and I did exactly I think 850 units of tin bronze, so I was able to fill all my ingot molds as well as finish off that pickaxe. That ought to leave someone satisfied. I'm sure it's been bugging someone, me mostly, but like someone else, I'm sure. But I figured, I like to change things up a bit. I did the silver, gold, bronze, and I've done the bismuth bronze, and I've done the tin bronze. So now, right now, I'm on bismuth bronze tools, and they're fine. They kind of look a little ugly, but whatever. It doesn't matter. You'd think that bismuth it would look like really colorful, because bismuth ends up being very colorful, but. I've resulted to try and watering the greenhouse garden, but I haven't yet put my theory into practice of, let's try uncovering the roof so that light is actually coming in. But I'll try that in the next episode. I kind of hope that doesn't work, if I'm being honest, because I don't want to have to do that every day. I guess it's worth it if I could actually get some more crops during the wintertime. So here we go. We're making shingles, and this is going to be very time-lapsed, and I've gone ahead and lowered the contrast just in case there was photosensitivity issues with this one. So hopefully that is helpful to someone out there. But my way of doing shingles now basically is there is a clean number of shingles on the left side that are untouched by the initial base of clay that you put down. So I finished those. And then I remove the base that it puts down. If you remove the base right away, then it thinks you're removing the entire thing. And so you just kind of get rid of the entire process. So you got to finish the left side that aren't touching the base. And then once you're done that, then you can finish the rest of the shingles after you've removed the base. I find using the 3x3 is the most easiest is the easiest way, but I don't know. I'm sure everyone has their own way of doing it. This seems to be the easiest way for me. I did drink a bunch of wine because that is our only source of calories right now. And as you could see, I was no longer able to make shingles because my screen was kind of waving all over the place, which is hilarious but also unproductive. So I've decided to go and do something a bit more, a task more suited to being drunk, which was to, I guess, burn things. That sounds like a good thing to do while you're trashed. So I was setting up the shingles to bake in the pit kilns. Haven't yet set that off, mostly because I'm gonna need a heck of a lot of grass and wood and sticks in order to set that all on fire. So that'll probably be, well, it is definitely going to be in a future episode because I didn't get to it in this episode. But in any case, I did start to go and like chop down some trees for the sake of getting that and also collecting some more grass. But, the whole thing is a work in progress. And obviously, if I'm going into the forest, I have run the risk of getting destroyed by a wolf, which I'm not sure if it happens here. I guess it'll be a surprise for both of us. But I did manage to find a heap of copper, which was nice. I'm pretty sure my pickaxe was just about dead, so I went ahead and removed the top layer of ground and then marked it on my map with the intention of coming back later, as you can see. Because I for some reason did not have my pickaxe was like just about broken, so that just didn't work. And there's our wolf. Do I actually end up killing this one? I think I do, which was great. I love it when I can actually end up killing the wolf, because there's a very good chance they will have fat on them, and this one didn't, however. So the wolves really are a gambit. What are you gonna do? We are starving here, and I'm not sure what I did for food to solve that situation. I think I went back to cattails. Cattails really are just not gonna cut it. And also, there's a finite number of cattails in my area. I don't really want to completely just uproot every single chunk of cattails. Oh, I see. We resort to drinking the last of the wine. And then we cook a couple of turnips. Okay, one turnip stew and, some wine. Nice. That sounds like a well-balanced meal for someone out there, I'm sure. Do not condone this, but, it's haha funny, right? So back to our farm. Still not figuring that out. We'll try in the next episode to make that situation better. I really hope I don't have to like replace the entire roof with glass. That would just be unideal. I would really not appreciate that. That's like very resource heavy. I mean, it's not a big deal because the bloomeries aren't too bad to make, but they are a two-step process. And you just end up having to do more clay forming and yeah, I'm kind of over it. I'm over the whole clay form. Actually, you don't have to clay form. The bricks are just crafted, which is kind of nice. But you do have to bake them. So it still ends up being a process. I actually played with the idea of trying to put a kit piln on top of ice just to see what would happen. And fortunately, I regained control of my senses and instead replaced the ice with some granite, or I think it was andesite. Andesite has become my main building resource now. And just before I ended the episode, I decided to get something done, literally anything. So I decided to finish that second floor with the rest of the oak, which means I'm gonna have to go and get some more oak for tanning, but I don't mind. Oak seems to be a really easy wood to obtain, because a tree will pretty much drop you enough wood to last you for months. So I'll probably go and find some more of that in the next episode as well. Also, in addition to fixing or finishing this last floor, I wanted to kind of set up the roof properly so that I could easily add in the pistons. Is it piston? It wouldn't be a piston. Someone's gonna tell me in the comments. For basically the mechanisms to make automation happen. That's going to be a long time because, unfortunately, since I made my house so large, I'm going to need a lot more materials to actually start automating. This is a bit of a downside, but it also means that this series is going to keep going. And look at this. This was such a heartbreak. After all the planning I had done, I was off by one square for my plan of like, oh yeah, this is where the mechanisms are going to come down and then for automation. So it is going to go through the cellar and then down here. I'm thinking I might actually build like a kind of a column around it, but I'm undecided on that yet. It's kind of nice just to have an aesthetic windmill right now. It really does feel like some kind of crazy accomplishment that I've been able to do something like that. And, why not cook some more cattails and make some more torches before we're fully finished? It's, it is a process mostly, it's a long process in part because it takes so long to get the resources you need to make some of these projects happen, but also because you have to manage so many things at once, like not just a roof over your head, but food. And, that involves farming and eventually animal husbandry and also collecting resources and metals and all kinds of stuff. Vintage Story is quite a beast when it comes to its like resource and food management. So I appreciate it for that, for sure. I guess in the next episode, I'll go check out that copper vein, see if I can't get some more copper. If you enjoyed this episode, definitely hit that like button and consider subscribing for more content like this. I'll see you guys next time. Take it easy. I'm gonna go get some more.